Hello students, welcome to Tungal Online Classes. So in this session we are going to study about the objective part of complex numbers. Okay, so whatever we studied, the concepts and formulas in PUC, so all those concepts again will be considered here. And apart from that, there will be some additional points and additional some shortcut methods will be there, so that we are going to discuss here. Okay, so first you have to go through all the PU part once again. Then we start the objective part. Okay, so in this first we study properties of modulus of complex numbers. Okay, already we studied in PU what are the properties of modulus of complex numbers. Now one property is modulus of z1 into z2, where z1 z2 are two complex numbers. Modulus of z1 into z2 can be written as mod z1 into mod z2. Next, modulus of z1 divided by z2 can be written as mod z1 divided by mod z2. Next, modulus of z power n can be written as mod z whole to the power of n. Next, in terms of conjugate and modulus, we have written the properties modulus of z same as modulus of z bar same as modulus of minus z same as modulus of minus z bar. Okay, next, z into z bar is modulus of z square, the product z into z bar, where z bar is conjugate of complex number z, so this product will be always modulus of z square. Okay, so this property is already we studied in PU. Now apart from this, there are some more properties. See, modulus of z1 plus z2, we are taking modulus of sum of complex numbers, it will be always less than or equal to modulus of z1 plus modulus of z2. Okay, sum of the complex numbers modulus is less than or equal to sum of modulus of their complex numbers. Now we can prove this by taking some example. Okay, any complex number is like z1 z2, this property is always holds. Next, modulus of z1 minus z2, it will also be less than or equal to mod z1 plus mod z2. Next, modulus of z1 minus z2, it will be greater than or equal to modulus of mod z1 minus mod z2, that is modulus of difference you have to take. Okay, so these three properties will be important when we are finding the minimum value of mod z or maximum value of mod z. So in such case we'll be using this last three properties. Understand? So these are some additional properties we are studying here in properties of modulus of complex numbers. Okay, next. So we studied about argument of complex number. So what is mean by argument of complex number? We know that any complex number z in the form of x plus iy, let z is equal to x plus iy. Every complex number can be represented as a point in a plane. The plane is called as argand plane or complex plane. So let z equal to x plus iy be any complex number which can be represented as a point in a plane called as argand plane, or it is also called the complex plane. Okay, so it can be represented as a point. What is that point here? P x comma y, where x is the real part of z and y is the imaginary part of z. So how do we are representing it as a point? This is the real axis and this is the imaginary axis. This is the origin. Suppose this is a point P, x comma y. So this plane is called as Argand plane. That also we studied already. Now what is meant by argument of complex number? Once we represented as a point in Argand plane. Now the line joining origin and that point. It makes some angle with the positive direction of real axis. So this angle is called as the argument of complex number denoted by theta. Okay, so we can get many arguments or many values of theta, where the point lies in first quadrant. Means we can take theta here. Next, after one complete revolution, we can take 2 pi plus theta. Now that also lies in first quadrant. After two rotations, 4 pi plus theta. That also lies in first quadrant, and so on. So we'll get infinite values of theta. But whenever we are discussing about argument, so it is a principal argument or principal amplitude we take. So for principal amplitude, how do we write angle here? If theta lies in minus pi to pi, minus pi less than theta less than or equal to pi, then theta is called as principal argument or amplitude of z. And we know how to find this theta. Okay, first quadrant angle we directly write as alpha, second quadrant angle it is pi minus alpha, third quadrant minus pi plus alpha, fourth quadrant it is minus alpha. So when we are solving, cos theta is x by r, sin theta equal to y by r, we have to find that angle. Okay, using this one of the four quadrant angles. This is what we studied in PUM. Okay, now in objective there is one shortcut method, or it is another method how to find this principal argument. Okay, now let us see how to find this principal argument here. Let z equal to x plus iy be any complex number . First we find tan inverse of mod y by x. First we'll find tan inverse of modulus of y by x. Okay, so after finding this value, now we can write directly the principal amplitude or principal argument of complex number depending on which quadrant the complex number lies. Now how do we know that which quadrant the complex number will lie? It depends on the sine of real part and imaginary part, sine of x and y. If both are positive, the point lies in first quadrant. If x is negative, y is positive, means real part negative, imaginary part positive, it lies in the second quadrant. Both are negative, real part negative, imaginary part negative, point lies in the third quadrant. Real part is positive, imaginary part is negative, the point lies in the fourth quadrant. If there is only real part and positive real part lies on the positive real axis, negative real part, we have only real part, there is no imaginary part. And if that real part is negative, it lies on negative real axis. If we have only imaginary part, it lies on imaginary axis. If it is positive, lies on positive imaginary axis. If imaginary part is negative, it lies on imaginary negative axis. Okay, so like this we can decide where the point is lying. So based on that we can write the principal argument here. Okay, so we can write this in the form of table. So here position where z lies, next we write principal argument or principal amplitude. So Suppose if z lies in first quadrant, okay, Q1 indicates z lies in first quadrant. Now when z lies in first quadrant, what is the angle we write? Alpha. So alpha is nothing but theta here. So principal argument, theta can be written as this tan inverse of mod y by x. Theta is tan inverse of mod y by x. So you don't have to write modulus here because both x and y are positive. Okay. Next, Q2. If the point lies in second quadrant, z lies in second quadrant, then how can write principal amplitude? Now it is pi minus alpha. So here alpha is nothing but tan inverse of y by x. Okay. So first we find alpha equal to tan inverse of mod y by x. So second quadrant angle we can write as pi minus alpha. What is alpha? Tan inverse of mod y by x. So here we have to take a positive value only for tan inverse. This is second quadrant. Next, if the point lies in third quadrant, we are writing angle as minus pi plus alpha because we are taking only the principal amplitude. So here theta will be minus pi plus alpha tan inverse of mod y by x. Next, if theta lies in fourth quadrant, what is theta again? Sorry, point lies in fourth quadrant, theta can be written as minus alpha. So minus tan inverse of mod y by x. Next, so these are the four quadrants. Now sometimes the point can lie on real axis or imaginary axis. If it lies on positive real axis, z lies on positive real axis. Then what will be theta? If the point lies on positive real axis, what is the angle made by this line joining the point with origin with x axis? So here theta will be 0. Theta will be 0 when the point lies on positive real axis. If it lies on positive imaginary axis, if the point lies on imaginary axis, positive imaginary axis, so line joining this point and origin, how much angle it makes with a positive real axis? 90 degrees. So positive 90. So theta will be pi by 2 or 90 degrees. If it lies on negative real axis, if the point lies on negative real axis, so if it lies here, now what is the line joining origin and this point makes with positive real axis? This angle will be 180 degrees or pi radians. So now theta will be pi radians. Next, if it lies on negative imaginary axis, if it lies on negative imaginary axis here, now the line joining origin and this point makes how much angle with the positive real axis? So this angle is 90, but we are measuring in a clockwise direction. So angle measured in clockwise direction is negative, angles measured in anti-clockwise direction is positive. So here theta will be minus pi by 2. So based on position of point, we can decide what is the principal argument or principal amplitude. So if you can remember this table, now directly we can write just by seeing the complex number and deciding which quadrant or the position of the point where it lies in the organ plane. So directly we can write what is the principal argument of complex number. Okay, so try to remember this table. So here we are writing tan inverse of y by x. How to find tan inverse of y by x? Actually we study this in second year part where we have one chapter called inverse trigonometric functions. Okay, I'll give you an example. How to find inverse trigonometric function value here in terms of tan inverse? Suppose we have tan inverse of 1 okay? So tan inverse 1 is how much? So here what you have to think is, for which angle tan is 1? Just think that, for which angle tan is 1? For pi by 4 tan is 1. So tan inverse of 1 will be pi by 4. In trigonometry we studied this, tan pi by 4 is 1. Now if I bring tan to right hand side, it will become inverse. So I can write pi by 4 as tan inverse of 1. Okay, so just think that for which angle tan is 1, then tan inverse 1 will be pi by 4. Similarly, if I want to find tan inverse of root 3, what you have to think is, for which angle tan is root 3, 60 degrees or pi by 3? So tan inverse root 3 will be pi by 3. If it is tan inverse of 0, for tan 0 we have 0, so tan inverse 0 will be 0. So this will be studying in second year. So just understand that how we are finding the tan inverse values here, okay? Now once we know the argument or principal argument of complex number, so how do we are writing the polar form, or it is also called mod amplitude form. Polar form are also called as mod amplitude form of complex number, okay? So any complex number is given z equal to x plus iy. Now this complex number we are representing in polar form by using modulus and amplitude of complex number. So let r equal to mod z is equal to root of x square y square. We know how to take modulus of complex number, and theta be the principal argument. Let theta be the principal argument, then we are writing polar form as, then polar form of z is z is equal to r into cos theta plus I sin theta. This is what mod amplitude form or polar form of complex number we studied, okay? So sometimes this also can be written as like this, r into, we write sis theta, okay? So r is same, cos theta plus I sin theta, in short sometimes we write as sis theta. So what sis indicates? C indicates cos, I indicates imaginary, S indicates sin, theta is the amplitude or argument, okay? So this is another notation for writing polar form of complex number, z is equal to r into sis theta, okay? Next we study about cube roots of unity. Cube roots of unity. So the concept is important here. Any competitive exam you take, compulsory questions will be there based on this cube roots of unity, okay? So what is mean by cube roots of unity? Unity means 1, cube root means power 1 by 3. So what are the roots of this cube root of unity? 1 power 1 by 3, okay? We are finding the roots of cubic root of 1. So 1 power 1 by 3, what are the roots? So for finding roots, let us take this value as x. Let us write x equal to 1 power 1/3. Okay, so we have to solve this and find x values. Cubing on both sides. Okay, since we have power 1/3, so cube on both sides. So what we'll get? X cube is equal to 1/1/3 whole power 1/3 is 1. Now solving this, x cube minus 1 is 0. X cube minus 1. Now 1 I can write as 1 cube. So it is in the form a cube minus b cube. What is the formula for a cube minus b cube? It is a minus b into a square plus ab plus b square. So here a is x, b is 1. Applying the formula, a minus b into a square plus a into b, x into 1 plus b square, 1 square is 1, is equal to 0. So we have a product of two terms is 0 means either x minus 1 is 0 or x square plus x plus 1 is 0. So either x equal to 1 or x square plus x plus 1 equal to 0. Can we write factors here? Factorization is not possible. So what we do is apply the roots formula of quadratic equation. So I can write x here. Ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0 form. Minus b. B is 1. Plus or minus root of b square. 1 square minus 4ac divided by 2a. 2 into 1. So what will be x value? Minus 1 plus or minus root of 1 minus 4 minus 3 divided by 2. So x equal to minus 1 plus or minus square root of minus 3. It is imaginary. I'll write as I root 3 divided by 2. So how many roots we are getting? So therefore x equal to 1 or x equal to, if I take plus minus 1 plus I root 3 by 2, if I take minus minus 1 minus I root 3 by 2. So these are the roots we are getting. How many roots we have? 3 roots. Why we are getting 3 roots? Because we have cubic equation. So cubic equation will have 3 roots. Now in these 3 roots, one is the real root and the other two are imaginary or complex roots. Okay, so these are the cube roots of unity. Okay, now we'll denote this roots as, this is 1 only. Now this minus 1 plus I root 3 by 2, we can denote it by omega, and minus 1 plus minus I root 3 by 2, this is omega square. Okay, so one root is 1, the other root denoted by omega, and the last root denoted by omega square. So we can say that 1, omega and omega square, these are the cube roots of unity, where omega is this value, omega square is this value. Okay, so hence 1, omega, omega square are the cube roots of unity. So I have to remember this omega and omega square values. Okay, minus 1 plus I root 3 by 2, minus 1 minus I root 3 by 2. Now there are some properties of this cube roots of unity. Okay, so again these properties are important. When we are solving the problems, this will be used. Okay, so first property is omega cube value is 1. Always omega cube value is 1. Observe here, since these are the cube roots of unity, so any value of this we substitute in this equation, it should satisfy the equation. So if I substitute x equal to 1, now 1 cube is 1, satisfies. If I substitute x as omega, so omega cube will be equal to 1. So this is a condition, omega cube value is always equal to 1. Even if I substitute omega square, we get omega power 6, can be written as omega cube whole square. Omega cube 1 means omega power 6 also 1. Not only omega power 3, you take omega power any multiple of 3, that value is always 1 only. Okay, so in fact omega power multiples of 3, so omega power 3n always equal to 1, for n belongs to z. So any value of integer we take, omega power 3n is always equal to 1. Next, so this is one condition. Another condition is, since 1 omega omega square, these are the roots of cube roots of unity. So we can see that x square plus x plus 1 equal to 0. So this equation has two roots, that is omega and omega square. Okay, so 1 is not the root of this one. 1 is root of only this equation, not for this. So for this equation, what are the roots? Omega and omega square. So in place of x, if I substitute omega, what we get? Omega square plus omega plus 1 equal to 0. So another condition we get, 1 plus omega square value always 0. Okay, these are the roots, means the equation must be satisfied by the roots. So in place of x, I write omega, then we'll get 1 plus omega square value is always 0. Okay, so these two properties will be used more when we are solving the problems based on cube roots of unity. Understand? Right. Next, rotation of a complex number through an angle in argand plane suppose a complex number is given, let z is equal to x plus iy be any complex number which represent as a point P x comma y in argand plane. Okay, see here diagram. So this is the real axis, imaginary axis, this is the origin. So we have the point P which corresponds to the complex number z. Suppose this is the point P, it may lie in anywhere. Okay, maybe first quadrant or second quadrant, third, fourth, or it may lie on x-axis, real axis or imaginary axis, anywhere you can take. Okay, so I am taking in first quadrant. Now the line joining OP, okay, now rotation of complex number through an angle in argand plane means, if I rotate this through an angle, maybe in anti-clockwise direction or clockwise direction, the line joining OP, so this line is rotated through some angle, okay, either in the anti-clockwise direction or clockwise direction, then what will happen? The position of point P changes. Okay, if I am rotating in anti-clockwise direction, it will get like this. So the position of point changes. Whenever the position of point changes, what will happen? The complex number z also changes, because xy coordinates are changed, means the complex number also changes. Okay, so how do we write the complex number in that new position? That is what we are going to study here. Okay, so in our syllabus we have only through rotation in clockwise or anti-clockwise direction through an angle of pi by 2, 90 degrees or 180 degrees. So only these two cases we have. See, how do we write that in when we are rotating in clockwise or anti-clockwise through an angle of 90 degrees or 180 degrees. First point, if we rotate this OP through an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction, if OP is rotated through an angle of pi by 2 in anti-clockwise direction, then Z changes as Z changes to, suppose I denote by Z1. Now that Z1 I can write as Z1 equal to I into Z, means the complex number Z, it will get multiplied by I. Okay, so the complex number will be multiplied by I. Whenever we are rotating the complex number through an angle of pi by 2 or 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so we will be getting the position of point somewhere here. Suppose this is P1. So P1 corresponds to the complex number Z1. How to obtain Z1? Just have to multiply Z, that is the original complex number, by I. Okay, next. So this is 90 degrees. If I rotate through an angle of 180 degrees, if OP is rotated through an angle of pi, again in anti-clockwise direction, then Z changes to, so this is the original point, original complex number. If I am rotating through an angle of 180 degrees, now 180 degrees means like this. Suppose this is P2. So we are rotating through an angle of 180 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. Now the new position of point, it corresponds to the complex number, suppose it is Z2. It is obtained by taking minus of Z. Okay, so you have to multiply minus 1 here, it will become minus Z. So minus 1 into Z, it is nothing but minus Z. Understand? Next, third case, this is in anti-clockwise direction. If I rotate in clockwise direction, if OP is rotated through an angle of pi by 2 in clockwise direction, then Z changes to, so this is OP. Now we are rotating this through an angle of 90 degrees, so it corresponds to P3, 90 degrees in a clockwise direction. Then the position of point changes to P3, which corresponds to some complex number Z3, which is equal to minus I into Z, corresponds to minus I into Z. Okay, so this is what Z3. Next, if I rotate through an angle of pi 180 degrees or pi in clockwise direction, rotating OP through an angle of 180 degrees in clockwise direction, again we will get P2 only. So 180 degrees, either we are rotating in anti-clockwise direction or clockwise direction, the position of point comes to only P2. So even if I rotate through 180 degrees in clockwise direction, again we will get P2 only, which corresponds to complex number minus Z. Understand? So we are having only through rotation of pi by 2 or pi in clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. So just remember these points, how the complex number changes. Okay, Next, there are some applications in complex numbers, okay, which will be used from other topics. Like there are applications of conic sections in complex numbers. Okay, so as per the reduced syllabus, the conic section part is deleted. Okay, but there are some questions which we have to solve by using the conic sections. Okay, so in this session, now I'll give some equations, diagrams, okay, related to this conic sections. Okay, equations, proof of all that that is not required. Just remember the equation and diagram. Okay, so conic sections. In conic sections, we are having a circle. So what will be the equation representing circle and different form of circle equations? Okay, so first we study standard form. Standard form of a circle equation, it is written like this. Equation is x square plus y square is equal to r square. Okay, circle x square plus y square equal to r square. Now for this circle, any circle, it will have center and radius. In the standard form, we have center is at origin 0 comma 0. In the standard form, center is at origin 0 comma 0, and radius equal to r. X square plus y square equal to r square. So radius is r. Understand? So this is the standard form of circle. Now diagram will get like this. So these are the coordinate axis, x axis, y axis. Now center of the circle is at origin and its radius is r. Understand? Next, this is a standard form. Next, we have central form of circle equation. Central form of circle equation, it can be written as x minus h whole square plus y minus k whole square is equal to r square form. So whenever you have equation of this form, it represents a circle. Now for this circle, center is at h comma k, and radius is r. Understand? So this is another form of circle equation when we know center h comma k and radius is r. So diagram we can take like this. Now center is not at origin, it is somewhere. Based on sign of h and k, the center may lie in first quadrant or second quadrant, third or fourth quadrants. Suppose this is a circle. Now here center is h comma k and its radius is r. Understand? Next, one more form of circle equation, it is called general form. So the general form of circle equation, it is written like this: x square plus y square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0. This is the general form of circle equation, which is obtained by expanding this and changing the notation. Okay, so this is the general form of circle equation with center. Center is at minus z comma minus f. Coefficient of x and y we have to consider for finding the center, and radius equal to root of g square plus f square minus c. Okay, radius is root of g square plus f square minus c. So diagram will be again somehow like this. So again, based on sign of f and g, center can lie in any one of the four quadrants or x axis, y axis. So this is center, minus z comma minus f, and this will be the radius. Okay, right. So this is about a circle equation and a diagram. So these are important. Okay, not only in complex numbers, these conic sections, will be very useful even in a second PU also. There are many applications of conic sections in a second PU. So we should know the equation and diagram compulsory. Okay, this is one conic section, circle. Next, another conic section we have parabola. Another conic section is parabola. Now in parabola we have four types. One is called right sided parabola. One is called right sided parabola, whose equation is y square equal to 4ax form. Whose equation is in the form y square equal to 4ax. Now diagram we can draw like this. So this will be the right sided parabola like this. So this will be extended up to infinite. Understand? Next, second one, left sided parabola. And its equation is written as y square equal to minus 4ax, where a is some constant. Okay, a is the constant. So it is like y square equal to minus 8x, or y square equal to minus 2x, or y square equal to minus x, whatever be that constant. Okay, we have minus x. It is the left sided parabola. So diagram will be like this. It is towards the left side of y axis. Again it is extended up to minus infinite. Okay, so this is left side parabola with equation and diagram. Next, third one, we have upward parabola, whose equation is in the form x square equal to 4ay, x square equal to 4ay form, like x square equal to 2y, or x square equal to y, or x square equal to 16y, like this. Diagram is upsided or upward, so parabola will be like this. Okay, next, fourth type, last type, it is a downward parabola, whose equation is x square equal to minus 4ay. Okay, x square equal to minus 4ay. Downward parabola we can draw like this, x axis, y axis. So this is a downward of x axis. So again is extended up to minus infinite. Understand? So these are the four parabolas we are studying with their equations and diagrams. Understand? Next, another conic section we are studying, it is a ellipse. So in ellipse we study two types of ellipse. So one is equation in the form x square by a square plus y square by b square equal to 1, where the value of a is greater than b, means denominator of x square is more compared to denominator of y square. So a greater than b, it is called first type of ellipse. Now we can draw a diagram like this. So ellipse will be like this. is x-axis, y-axis. Now center of ellipse is at origin. Now these are the points we can write A, it is A comma 0, point on x-axis. This is A dash minus A comma 0. This is B, 0 comma B. This will be B dash 0 comma minus B. Okay. So this A dash, this length is called major axis, B, B dash, it is called minor axis. So length along x-axis is more, major axis along x-axis, it is of a first type of ellipse. Next, second type of ellipse, again equation is same, x square by a square plus y square by b square equal to 1. Now here a value is less than b, means denominator of y square is more. Now ellipse will be like this. Okay, this will be the ellipse. This is y axis, x axis. This is center at origin. Again, this is the point on x axis, a comma 0. Point on negative x axis, minus a 0. Point on y axis, 0 comma b. Negative y axis, it is b dash, 0 comma minus b. Now you can see that length along y axis is more. So major axis is along y axis. This is called minor axis along x axis. So when denominator of y square is more, now ellipse is of second type where major axis is along y axis. Understand? So these are the second type of ellipse. So you have to remember the equation and diagram. Next, last conic section we study hyperbola. Okay, hyperbola. Now in hyperbola also we study two types. First type is in the form x square divided by a square minus y square by b square equal to 1. This is the first form of hyperbola. Now diagram will be like this. X axis, y axis, this is the center at origin. Now diagram will be like this. For hyperbola. Okay, so again this will be extended up to infinite minus infinite on both the sides. Next, so if you see that curve is along x-axis, okay, curve is along x-axis, this is the first type of hyperbola. Next, second type of hyperbola, equation we write like this, x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to minus 1, plus 1, it is first type, minus 1, it is the second type. Okay, so we draw second type of hyperbola like this. Now the curve will lie along the y axis, so curve will be like this. Okay, so again this will extend up to infinite on both the ends. So this is the second type of hyperbola. Okay, so if it lies on x-axis, it is called transverse axis. If it lies along y-axis, it is called conjugate axis. Okay, so actually all these points we'll study in the chapter of conic sections. So as of now, we just remember the equation and the diagram. Okay, because when we solve the questions, we'll get some equation. Okay, but in the options, that equation will not be given. Sometimes they will give the name. Okay, so we are getting some equation and options, they are giving some name. So by observing that equation, we should know that is it a circle or parabola, ellipse or hyperbola. Okay, so once we know that, then only we can answer here. So that's why we are going through this equation and curves once. Okay, so all of you go through these conic sections also to solve the problems on complex numbers. Okay, so this is the theory part related to conic sections, objective part. So from next class we'll start the numericals. Okay, thank you.